baptism is a symbol of what Jesus did for us
in his death, burial, and resurrection.
Being lowered in the water represents our old life dying.
Just as Jesus was dead and buried,
our past and future sins are gone forever.
We are forgiven.
When we are raised out of the water,
it represents our new life in Christ.
Just as Jesus was resurrected, we are a new creation.
The old is gone. The new has come.
Today
we celebrate as people take their next step and tell the world that Jesus has brought them from death
to life. Today we celebrate the miracle of a changed life
based upon their profession in Jesus Christ.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit,
we are buried with Christ
and raised to walk
in newness of life.
Good morning. It is indeed a pleasure to see all of you on this not so much cold, but really icy day. We're glad that you have taken the time to come out and worship with us. If you're worshiping online, we welcome you to this time of worship as well. And we ask that a couple things from you as you are worshiping online, that if you would hit the like button, that would help get us out to as many people as possible. And then also in the comment section, as we come into our time of prayer and raise up our joys and concerns a little bit later in the service, if you have a joy or concern that you'd like to share with us, use that comment section. We have people who will be watching that and we'll be able to lift that up. And we'd also like to lift that up then as we go into our time of prayer during the week. But we're glad that you have taken the time to worship with us as well. A couple of announcements I want to lift up. One is, I know a lot of people are asking how are Don and Sheila, and we'll talk about that during our prayer concerns. They are doing well. As well as can be expected. They have been released from the hospital. They are in a care facility in Marietta. And we'll talk more about that then when we get into our joys and concerns. A couple other announcements I want to lift up. Year-end statements, if you use these for tax purposes or want them, they are available. They are on the back table back on that side of Fellowship Hall, as well as offering envelopes that if you use those to give your offering, you can pick up the offering envelopes back there as well. There's a signature there where you can sign the number of the envelope that you have so that as Dave is doing his counting on the money on Sunday afternoons that he'll know who gave what there. So both of those are available on the back table. A couple other announcements I want to lift up. I've been asked if I would do a confirmation class. We have a couple of youth that are at that age that would like to join the church, and I would be honored to do that. What I need to work out with the parents, if you have a child that is that confirmation class, age limit, that we sit and talk about what that would look like in terms of when we would meet, whether it would meet during a Sunday or during Sunday morning Sunday school, whether it be an evening type, what would work best with you. And I'm pretty flexible to be able to work with you on what that would look like. The object would be to meet with these on a regular basis, with these kids on a regular basis, and have them join the church then on Easter Sunday. So I'm looking forward to being able to teach that. We also had a couple of our visitors who are have been regular attendees who have requested that they join the church. And so I'll be meeting with them over the course of the next couple of weeks, setting up time when what it means to be United Methodist, what it means to be United Methodist in this congregation, and then have them join the church as well. So it's exciting things I think are happening here in the congregation. I'm really looking forward to it as we go into the time of the new year. We got other prayer concerns that we'll lift up as well when we come to that time of worship. We're glad to have our praise team back. Whatever number's here, we're glad to have you. We are fortunate to have you, so we're glad to have you. Come into a time of worship as we unite our voices together in our opening prayer. Holy God of glory and majesty, you have called us by name. We pray in this moment for the courage and the strength to answer your call As we open our ears to hear the story of your son's baptism, open our hearts also, that we may experience again the renewing power of rebirth in the Holy Spirit. Inspire us in this time of worship, that we may claim our identity as your beloved children. We pray in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's prepare our hearts and minds then as we go into a time of worship, as we listen to our prelude and then followed by our praise team.
Yes. Doug Walker will not be here till spring because they head south, and this is not my forte introducing the songs, but we'll do the best we can. The other thing is you're going to get let in on a couple praise team secrets because Barb and I have a lower range, or the two Dougs have a higher range, and so when they're here, we kind of, on the high notes, we kind of pull our mic back and let them take it, and we can't do that anymore. So that secret is exposed. So my point is we need your help, and this first song especially, Shout to the Lord, gets a little high, but it's also just about praising God, and the Bible says, make a joyful noise. It doesn't say make a joyful noise perfectly or on key. So whatever you can, there you go, Pastor Pete. So whatever you can give us this morning to sing to God, we would appreciate it. So stand if you are able and join us in songs.
Of your mighty love.
I'd like at this time to invite those United Methodist women who will be taking office, if they would come forward at this point. And I'm going to invite you as a congregation to help me in the installation process. I'm going to give this microphone first to them, and if they would give their name and what office they are assuming.
Ruth Babiak, President.
Sylvia Gray, Secretary.
Janet Jones, Vice President.
Sandy Haggerty, and that leaves Treasurer for me.
The Money Man. I'm going to invite you to take part in there. There are things for me to say, there are things for them to say, and there are things for you to affirm as well. So let's unite our voices at the appropriate time. And God said, "See, I am doing a new thing. Do you not perceive it?"
From the chaos before creation came life as we know it.
So from the chaos of brainstorming and details and more details, come successful meetings and training programs.
Count me in.
Being an officer is grounded in one's commitment to the faith heritage of United Methodist women, more than 100 years of mission making.
Mission making results can transform lives through ministries of schools, medical facilities, worship, child care, job training, theological study. The Hebron United Methodist Women helps mission happen through the financial giving, leadership development, study, and prayer of its members.
We are all needed to create a safe, spirit-filled world in which we live. Count us in.
Count us in.
I declare these officers duly installed, and I charge them and this gathered congregation with being a supportive congregation for each other as you participate in the work of mission making.
O God, giver of creative energy, receiver of mission making, within us and all around us, awaken that spark of divine energy in action. Let our hearts hear the song of transformed lives. Let our eyes see hope again in the walk and talk of free men and women, girls and boys. Let our bodies dance with the visions of love offered in the example of Jesus Christ. Amen. Now to install in your offices, and we thank you for your service. Would you congratulate? United Methodist Women, it's one of the mainstay of almost all United Methodist churches. United Methodist Men have kind of come and gone. There are some churches that have United Methodist Men that are still operating, still functioning. But United Methodist Women are strong throughout this congregation, throughout this conference. And we give you thanks for all that you do in the mission field. If we go into time of prayer, there are a couple of announcements I want to give you that have been brought to us. Carolyn Thatcher, some of you may know that name, is under hospice care. She used to be a regular tender, is my understanding. I have some conversation going on with her daughter. But as we get more information and as that develops further, we'll let you know. Lynn Eiler's sister-in-law, Pete Carter, hospitalized with COVID and pneumonia. And so keep that family as well as Lynn. And Mike Scobie has some health issues, is seeing a neurologist. So keep Mike and Diana and your prayer concerns as well. Got information to share with you on Sylvia and Sylvia on Sheila and Don. They are in a rehab facility. Now, initially, we were told they were going to be in the same room in Marietta. They are not. Don is in room 256B, and Sheila is in 235A. Now, if you want those information, Len will have that in the office tomorrow, along with the complete address at the Manicare Rehab Center in Marietta, Georgia, so that you can
send them cards. They both have their cell phones. They are taking calls. They may be in therapy, so you may miss them. Don has suggested that you text them before you actually call to see if they are available, but they would welcome any calls that you have. I know some of you have already had several calls with them. I've talked with Don and Sheila both, and then under the circumstances, they're doing well. They will be in the rehab facility for, who knows, 4 to 5 weeks, at which time they will come back to Hebron. And so when they come back, as that gets closer to that time happening, we will be looking at what we can do as a congregation to help them in their adjustment of getting back into being able to walk again, to do the things that they need to do. So in terms of meals and whatever else they need, transportation to and from of medical doctors and stuff, when that gets closer to that time happening, we will share that information for you so that we could put something together that could help them through that process. Those are all the prayer concerns that I'm aware of. Again, if you are watching online and you have a prayer concern, if you would simply put that in the comment section, we'll pull that off and certainly get it out to our congregation to share those prayer concerns that you may have. Let's sing our prayer song, the Spirit song, verse 1, and then we'll go into a time of silence, allowing you to take your prayer concerns to God or simply listen for God to speak to you, and then I'll close with prayer. Spirit, whose voice we hear in the winds, whose breath gives life to all the world, hear us as we come before you. As your children, we are small and weak. We need your strength and your wisdom. Let us walk in beauty and make our eyes ever behold the red and purple sunset. May our hands respect the things that you have made. Our ears be sharp to hear your voice. Make us wise so that we may know the things that you have taught your people, the lessons that you have hidden in every leaf and in every rock. Lord God, we seek strength not to be superior to our brothers and our sisters, but to live in harmony with ourselves and all of your creation. Our prayer is that you would help us to be ever ready to come to you, so that when life fades as a fading sunset, our spirits may come to you without shame. Oh God, over the last year we've lived in darkness, in despair, in fear and doubt and strife. So on this day of celebration, this holy day where we gather as your people, as we celebrate the baptism of your Son. Remind us that we are all marked to be your witnesses, to be witnesses to the light of new hope. And as the heavens opened up at Jesus' baptism, so is your love poured out on all of us. So, Lord God, we come to you in this holy place at this holy time, bringing you names and situations which concern us, people who face illness and grief, whose lives are torn by poverty and war and alienation, addiction, hopelessness. So we ask for your loving mercy on them, O Lord, that you would heal them, that you would bind up their wounds. But God, we also bring to you names of friends and family who need your healing touch. So we lift up to you Carolyn and Pete and Mike, Don, Sheila. We lift up to you those who are listed on our prayer concerns. Lord God, you know each and every one of those concerns, of those situations. So our prayer is that you would pour out your healing spirit on these individuals, on these families. That you would provide the healing that is so necessary. We especially lift up to you Don and Sheila involved in that terrible accident. And God, we give you thanks for the healing that has taken place. We know that there is much to be done. Our prayer is that you would guide us as a congregation on where you are calling us to help any of these people, to be involved in any of that situation, to provide hope and love and care that only comes because of the love we have for you and the love we have for each other, the love that you have told us to share with one another. Lord God, we pray for our nation. As this pandemic continues to affect so many people, Lord God, we pray that you would simply guide us on how we are to go forward. How are we to live our lives? How are we to safeguard our families and still live our lives? So God, we ask that you would simply guide us, the decisions that we make to protect ourselves, to protect our family and our friends, to do the things that we are called to do for the love that we have for each other. God, we pray then for our medical professionals, those doctors and nurses in the hospitals, but those first responders. Pray that you would do your best to keep them from harm's way, that you would shower them with your cloak of protection. We pray for our leaders at all levels of government. Pray that you would guide them in their decisions. Help lead our cities, our states, our country forward in new directions. Lord God, we pray for our young men and women in the armed forces and pray that you would do your best to keep them from harm's way. We lift up to you their families, oftentimes separated for unknown lengths of time, not knowing the danger one may be in. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon them, that in the midst of that separation, they would feel your presence, and in that presence, they could find comfort and hope. Lord God, we pray and give thanks. We give thanks for these officers of the UMW that have been installed, for the commitment they have made, not only to the United Methodist Women, but in this church. We pray your Holy Spirit would surround them, to give them the strength to do the jobs they have been called to do. Lord God, we know that there are those in this congregation that are hurting for unknown reasons. So we take just a moment now of silence, allowing them to come to you in their own silence and listen for you to speak to us. You are a loving and caring God who cared so much for your people that you sent your Son, our Lord and Savior, to live and die for us so that we could have eternal life. And so we come to you at this point in this service to not only offer these prayers, to pray the prayer that he taught us with these words, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you always for your continued faithfulness as you continue to send your tithes in. Allow us to do the things that we do, not only in this community, but in this conference for the state of Indiana. We have a prayer of dedication. Unite our voices together as we give thanks. Gracious God, we come today with joy for your baptism. We come with praise for your glory. We come with gratitude for your love. As we offer these gifts to you, send your Spirit upon us, that our hands and our hearts may do the work in the world. We offer our lives to you. Bless us with your strength, that we may join with you to work for the blessings of peace throughout the world. Amen. Unite our voices together as we sing the Sweet, Sweet Spirit song. Thank you.
This morning, our scripture reading comes from Luke chapter 3, verses 15 through 17 and 21 through 22. The people were waiting expectantly and were all wondering in their hearts if John might possibly be the Messiah. John answered them all, "I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I will come, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire." When all the people were being baptized, Jesus was baptized too, and as he was praying, heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove, and a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Dana, for that. So it's pretty much common acceptance that Jesus' public ministry began with his baptism. Now, you may have question, if Jesus is, in fact, the Son of God, then why did Jesus have to be baptized? Understanding that where this is taking place, that John the Baptist has come out of the wilderness and is proclaiming this repentance of sins, forgiveness for the sins. And John is doing this baptism, and so Jesus is coming to John, asking him to be baptized, this repentance and forgiveness of sins. But if Jesus is the Son of God, sinless, then why? Why did Jesus need to be baptized? Every year on this Sunday, we read about the baptism. Now, it may come from a different gospel reading, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Every year, the first Sunday after the Christmas year, so we have Christmas, we celebrate Christmas, and then we celebrate Epiphany, the arrival of the wise man, and the very next Sunday is the baptism of Jesus. And every year in the lectionary, it takes its turn, whether it's from the reading from Matthew or Mark or Luke. And so this year we are in year C. Year A is Matthew, year B is Mark, year C is Luke. And we read about Luke's account of this baptism, who really just kind of puts it out there as if, well, it's just Jesus was baptized. In fact, Luke seems to speak around it when you look at his actual words. Now, when all the people were baptized, and Jesus had also been baptized, referring really as something that has simply taken place with the baptism of other people. And then Luke moves to what follows. We have Jesus praying. We have the descent of the Holy Spirit. We have the heavenly voice declaring him as God's beloved Son, and that's it. And it almost is an afterthought that Luke wants to downplay somewhat this baptism, and he doesn't want to emphasize it so much. Now, when you look at Matthew's gospel deals with it a little differently. Matthew has John the Baptist objecting, if you will, saying, "You come to me when you should be baptizing me." And Jesus convinces John to do the baptism, that this is, in fact, the proper thing to do. And so John baptizes Jesus. When we look at the Gospel of John, when we look at how John describes it, John really doesn't say much about it at all. He says, John describes, like, here comes the Lamb of God. Takes away the sins of the world. And we had the dove descending on, the Spirit descending on him. And John really never specifically says that Jesus was baptized. And then we get to Mark. You know, Mark's account is very straightforward. And you know, if you read Mark, understand Mark is right to the point. And everything happens. You know, when you read Mark, understand that Mark has got one purpose to do, and that's to identify Jesus as the Son of God. And everything happens now. Immediately. This takes place. Understand that most scholars will agree that the Gospel of Mark is the earliest gospel ever written. That Matthew and Luke borrowed a lot of the information from Mark as they wrote theirs. And in Mark, Jesus' baptism is straightforward. Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee, was baptized by John in the Jordan River. That's it. The heavens are torn apart. The Spirit descends. The heavenly voice responds. Why do all three of them treat the baptism a little differently, and John doesn't really mention it at all? Well, understand this. Understand that the Christian thought about who Jesus actually was took time to develop for those early believers. And that development happened over a period of time and was somewhat uneven even. So the question that we're asked to really look at today is a question that you have to really just stop and think about for yourself. Who is Jesus for you? If all the gospel writers write about it somewhat differently, who is Jesus for you? Why did Jesus need to be baptized? If Jesus is the Son of God, and God cannot sin, if Jesus is sinless, then why? Why did Jesus need to be baptized? The question that I want to ask you to think about today, not only today, but over this week, is what is the meaning? What is the purpose? Why did Jesus go through this? The early Christians, during Jesus' life and ministry on earth, during Jesus' time on earth, there's those early followers came to believe certain things. So the earlier followers knew that Jesus had done some great things, you know. I mean, his insight into human nature, his understanding and his ability to explain to you the meaning of Scripture was something that they had not experienced before. Those early Christians had witnessed Jesus doing some mighty acts of healing and of feeding. And then they had witnessed the messages that he had provided, messages of loving one another. And those messages appealed to the mass people, especially those people who were leading a hard life. Now, when we look at his disciples, or those group of followers, they really came to understand that Jesus was special. But initially, they too thought that he was simply one of the prophets, like one of the prophets of old. There were even those who would say that and proclaim that he was, in fact, God's Messiah, but understand what they meant when they said that he was God's Messiah. The Messiah was someone who was going to be anointed by God to overthrow their captives, to overthrow the Roman Empire, to overthrow this oppressive form of government that they had, and to restore them with a king that would be, that would take after that great King David. It wasn't until Jesus died on a cross, not only died on the cross, but that third day when he rose again, when he appeared to his disciples, it wasn't until then that the disciples really started to think about who he was. To really get this feeling that, you know what, he is more than just a prophet. More than just a great king. I mean, his resurrection gave them a different thought process, a different understanding. Not only who he was, but how was God working through him? There were even some that began to proclaim that the God of Israel was now acting decisively through Jesus to reconcile, to save all of his people. But it really wasn't until Saul, on his road to Damascus, when he was converted, when he became the Apostle Paul, wasn't until Paul actually began to proclaim him the Son of God that that title started to take hold. And that he was, in fact, then people began to understand him and accept him as the Son of God who came to us in human form. So when you read about, you know, if you look at the Old and the New Testament, you'll find that in this, in many places, initially, Jesus is lifted up as an object of faith, as he's placed alongside God as an object of faith. And it wasn't until much later that when we finally started to accept this understanding of his resurrection, his ascension, to accept the understanding that he now sits at the right hand of God the Father, that we begin to understand this statement, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. Paul began to preach that message. The disciples began to preach that message. It wasn't until the end of the first century, I mean, really towards the end of the first century, that this understanding that Jesus, in fact, was fully divine and fully human, that people began to understand what that meant. The Gospel of John says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh and lived among us. And we begin to have this understanding of who Jesus was. That he was the Son of God, that he was fully divine, and yet at the same time, fully human. And it's that concept that people have a hard time of trying to accept. It's easy to understand and believe that he, in fact, was the Son of God. In fact, we get upset. rightfully so, we'll get upset, and when we hear or read or experience someone who tries to convince us that he wasn't divine, that he was nothing more than a great teacher or a great prophet. We get upset at those teachings. But likewise, we should also get upset at those teachings that would try to convince us that he was simply divine and that he wasn't human. Because we experience words and hymns that sometimes would try to convince us otherwise. We sing the Mary's child, veiled in the flesh, the Godhead see. Words that would suggest that God's humanity is just superficial. It really is not material. Just a disguise. Or we have Christmas cards that show the Bethlehem stable surrounded in light. Symbolism. Symbolism trying to convince us of one thing. You understand, baby Jesus didn't glow in the dark. He was fully human. Fully divine. So we read the Apostle Paul when he writes these words, though he took the form of God, he emptied himself. Emptied himself, also taking the form of a slave. Or as another prophet, he had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. So this Sunday, as we look at this scripture lesson, as we look at the words of Luke, we just kind of gloss over it, and so Jesus was baptized. What does it mean for you? If in fact Jesus was the Son of God, why did he have to be baptized? God is sinless. Jesus is the Son. Jesus is sinless. Baptism is a sign of forgiveness for the repentance of sins. Why did Jesus need to be baptized? We simply need to go back to the Gospel of John that says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word became flesh, and lived among us. Understanding that throughout Scripture, the word flesh oftentimes means or suggests vulnerability, weakness. So what happens after Jesus is baptized? Well, we read about what he goes out into the desert. He's tempted, right? He's tempted by the devil. He responds to those temptations. But what happens? What do we read when he was crucified? We truly understand the torture that he went through. Do we truly understand how he hungered and thirsted? How he felt those scourges from the Roman whip? How he felt the nails piercing his hands and feet? How he felt pain and suffering. Because it's that understanding of pain and suffering that brings us to the understanding that Jesus, in fact, was human. That he feels what you feel. That he understands the pain that you may be going through. That he's been there. And he knows what it's like. Baptism is a symbol that we go through acknowledging that Jesus, in fact, not only was fully divine, but he is fully human. That he experiences everything that we've experienced. And yet still remains faithful. It's that solidarity that he has with his Father, his ability to remain faithful, is what we can draw that strength on. That says, no matter what the trials are that you are experiencing, no matter what pain you may feel, whether it's physical pain or the pain of losing someone you love, that Jesus, in his divinity and in his humanity, understands and offers you hope for your future. It's a symbol that we experience the baptism of Jesus, not that he was a sinful person, but rather that he could take our sins and lay them all upon him so that we could have eternal life. That he offers us this promise that who shall ever believeth in him shall never die, but have eternal life. So Luke isn't trying to just gloss over it. He isn't trying to hide the fact that Jesus was baptized. In fact, he's trying to highlight the fact that he was baptized for you and I. So that we would understand his humanity, his willingness to accept our pain so that we could have eternal life. Who is Jesus Christ for you today? The question that only you can decide. What does his baptism mean for you? How will you lead your life with that new understanding? In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
I believe he died and rose.
always amazes me. I give the praise team my theme, and they pick the music, and how well God puts that music to what we're trying to understand today. I believe. What do you believe? Who is Jesus for you? Not only this day, but for eternity. As we leave, I'd ask that the officers of EMW, if you would stay and come up forward. Dave is going to take some pictures that we want to take of you before we get out of here. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you this day and every day. Go in peace. The peace of God goes with you. Amen. And amen.
Heal now.